Privilégio para mim poder recolher todos nesta manhã, sol em Lisboa, para este encontro que reúne investigadores de quatro continentes do mundo. E, em primeiro lugar, gostaria de dar um agradecimento a todos os participantes, não apenas aos oradores, mas também àqueles que nos acompanham e também a todos aqueles que colaboraram na preparação desta iniciativa. E, se me permitem, permitam-me destacar, de facto, que o sucesso está garantido, não apenas pela qualidade das comunicações, mas também, de facto, pela qualidade da audiência. Só espero que durante estes dias seja possível aprofundarmos as comunicações, os debates, não apenas aqui na sala, mas também fora da sala. A minha segunda palavra é de saudade e tristeza. Saudade da professora Vera Albanon, tristeza por não podermos ter aqui connosco. Este colóquio foi pensado e preparado também por essa nossa colega. Como é sabido, a sua morte inesperada e trágica deixa-nos aqui com esse vazio que tentaremos depois completar em breve com a realização de uma sessão especial, homenagem dos estudos também em homenagem à nossa querida colega, professora Isabel Manon. A minha terceira palavra é uma palavra de agradecimento também a todos os colaboradores e também àqueles que de algum modo ajudaram a preparar este corpo. Não apenas os meus colegas no Centro de Investigação, o professor Eduardo Vera Cruz, Isabel Garagas e Pedro Caridade Freitas, mas também às pessoas que colaboraram na seleção dos papers que vão ser aqui apresentados, permite-me aqui destacar a professora Margarida Seixas, Miriam Brigues, Ana Foto, Felipe Teia, sem contar ainda com a colaboração sempre inestimável da doutora Cláudia Guarda. Portanto, para mim é um grande privilégio poder estar aqui a presidir este colóquio, mas o trabalho é de facto um trabalho coletivo. Discutir a liberdade hoje em dia, discutir os direitos humanos, discutir os mitos fundadores e as perspectivas históricas, o título deste tema, o título desta conferência, um pouco provocador, foi pensada como um desafio numa época que também desafia a nossa compreensão dos direitos do homem. A escolha deste tema, Nico dizia, é uma interpelação para historiadores, para filósofos, para juristas e, no fundo, para todos aqueles que estão interessados com a situação atual dos direitos do homem. E, ao longo destes dois dias, vai ser possível, através dessa diversidade das comunicações, podemos, de facto, ter essa oportunidade para um diálogo aprofundado entre filósofos, juristas e historiadores. E é por isso um grande privilégio para mim, e vou terminar estas brevíssimas palavras de apresentação com esta saudação a todos, mas com a apresentação de um orador que é um bom amigo de Portugal, o professor Ossi Dito, que é um bom amigo de Portugal, na medida em que já esteve várias vezes em Portugal, não apenas nesta universidade, mas noutras, tem obra publicada, traduzida em língua portuguesa pela Fundação Gulbenkian, ou certamente este propósito de estudar de forma detalhada a história dos direitos humanos e é também um investigador cujas publicações são fundamentais para o estudo da história do constitucionalismo e dos direitos do homem. Em especial, recordo a grande investigação realizada pelo professor Hostitle, Constitutions of the World, que constitui, de facto, um marco referencial para quem quer estudar o surgimento do constitucionalismo e também o surgimento dos direitos do homem. O professor Hostitle é, além de mais, um estudioso da história do constitucionalismo e dos Estados Unidos da América, e é mesmo uma das referências principais na Europa para o estudo da experiência constitucional norte-americana. So, of course, I was presenting yourself in Portuguese. I'm very glad to have you here with us. I just explained your fantastic curricula in the field of history of law, history of the United States, history of constitutionalism, and history of human rights. And so we are extremely pleased for having you here. It's really a privilege. Thank you for being here with us. Of course, you are the floor. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, people, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the privilege to be here and to have the honorific task to open this conference with a contribution which should be right with the question mark at the end of it. Human rights, a European hypocrisy. Now, this is a question, it's not a statement. Europeans tend to be proud of their centuries-old history of human rights, the roots of which we like to trace back to Greek antiquity. What philosophers such as Plato or Aristotle conceived as ideas almost 2,500 years ago, spelled out today in court rulings. A widely publicized recent example of our assumed long-standing human rights heritage is the ruling of the French Conseil d'État of the 26th of August 2016 on wearing burkinis in public beaches in a number of French Mediterranean seaside resorts. One of the plaintiffs was the French Ligue des Droits de l'Homme, protesting against a prohibition which in its use was a plain violation of human rights. The ruling judge adopted this view and concluded in remarkably general terms and without providing any legal foundations that l'arrêté contesté a porté une atteinte grave et manifestement illégale aux libertés fondamentales qui sont la liberté d'aller et venir, la liberté de conscience et la liberté personnelle. Rene, however, insists that not any right propagated, reclaimed, or granted is by its very nature a human right, which instead engulfs only those, quote, rights and freedom to which every human being is entitled. We may leave aside, for the purpose of this article, the discussion of whether human rights are a myth or a utopia, and draw a much narrower line, rigidly sticking to the phrase and its meaning instead of constructing or inventing traditions which may be dubious and the invocation of which may only tend to blur the argument, especially when too easily today's concepts are projected back into previous centuries. Just one example may suffice. In the text of the German Grundgesetz, the German Constitution of 1949, the terms Grundrechte, basic or fundamental rights, and Menschenrechte, human rights, are to a large extent equivalent. 100 years ago, in the Paulskirche debates, they substantially differed in meaning and were clearly opposed to each other. Convinced that any meaningful discussion has to use historical terms and phrases in the sense they were understood in their specific times, we may acknowledge that this Aristotle stressed the importance of courts in a democracy, and that he recognized natural law as universal and valid without human endorsement. In the same sense, Vattel, 2,000 years later, and still closely following Cicero, defined natural law as founded in the, quote, nature of things and of men in particular. But none of them ever spoke of human rights in today's meaning. Neither did the American settlers in the decades up to 1776. When they insisted on their rights, which British colonial policy endangered according to their understanding. On the 6th of December 1775, the Continental Congress declared categorically, quote, by the British Constitution, our best inheritance, rights, as well as duties, is stand upon us. End of quote. Security of rights was a fundamental principle of the British Constitution, which Americans in all these years never doubted, nor that these rights belonged to them. The Georgia resolutions of the 10th August 1774 have resolved, quote, that the act of abolishing the Charter of Massachusetts Bay tends to subversion of American rights, for, besides those general liberties, the original settlers brought over with them as their birthright, particular immunities were granted by such charter as an inducement and means of settling the province, end quote. As Americans were born with these rights, they could not be taken from them without their consent. In addition, the meeting at Savannah included a resolution that may stand as a blueprint for a provision hardly any future American constitution would admit, quote, that it is contrary to natural justice and the established law of the land to transmit any person to Great Britain or elsewhere to be tried on indictment for a crime committed in any of the colonies. As the party prosecuted would thereby be deprived of the privilege of trial by his peers from the vicinage, the injured perhaps prevented from legal reparation, and both lose the full benefit of their witnesses. End quote. Americans regarded it as self-evident that rights were fundamental in a most practical manner, not an abstract theory. The preamble of the New Hampshire Constitution of the 5th of January 1776 reproached Britain of, quote, depriving us of our native and constitutional rights and privileges, end quote. But the same was expressed by the rules and regulations of the colony of Georgia of the 5th of April 1776, declaring that the British policy had driven Americans, quote, to take up arms as their last resource for the preservation of their rights and liberties which God and the Constitution gave them. What the Americans addressed and reclaimed were rights, which were theirs, brought over by the settlers from England, not abstract, theoretical human rights, a term completely unknown to them. Starting with the Virginia Declaration of Rights of the 12th of June 1776, they declared these rights. In none of these American declarations or Bill of Rights, as they subsequently became known more commonly, at least up to the Civil War and not until today, appeared the phrase human rights. With a big step to the final decades of the 20th century, we may add that Americans speak of the civil rights revolution of these decades, not a human rights revolution. And the most widely spread law dictionary in the United States does not even know the term human rights. However, we have to admit that 15 American constitutions contain the phrase called the invaluable rights of man and every citizen. The example is intriguing, though a closer look reveals that the phrase belongs to two parts of a provision on the liberty of the press. The whole sentence runs, quote, the free communication of thoughts and opinions is one of the invaluable rights of man, and every citizen may speak freely, write, and print on the subject, being responsible for the use of that liberty. The The phrase appeared first in the Constitution of Pennsylvania of 1790 and was repeated in its Constitution of 1838 and in the Constitutions of Kentucky of 1792, 1799 and 1850, of Tennessee of 1796 and 1834, Louisiana of 1812, Indiana 1816, Illinois 1818 and 1848, Missouri, though modified, 1820 and 1846, Texas with the same modification, 1833, and Arkansas of 1836, thus drawing a line of constitutional design in the United States between the Revolution and the Civil War. What is more important in our context is that the provision is a word-by-word translation of Article 11 of the French Déclaration des droits de l'homme et des citoyens of 1789, breaking, as the original does, the invaluable rights of man down to a single right, which in the second step, the exception of Missouri and Texas, was transformed into a human right, from a human right into a civil right. All this may be surprising, as the famous words of the Declaration of Independence still ring in our ears with its self-evident truth that all men are created equal and have certain inalienable rights. These words mark the zenith of the revolutionary enthusiasm during the summer of 1776. And Thomas Jefferson, a philosopher heavily inspired by the French Enlightenment and always remembered for pointed phrases, was the man to give it lasting expression. But its statement, it did not use the term human rights either, corresponded neither to the political reality of the 13 states, where a fifth of the population was held in bondage, not to mention the situation of the indigenous Native Americans, nor did it translate into definite constitutional provisions to unconditionally secure these rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The American discussion underlines in a resounding way that human rights were invented by the French Revolution. The French Enlightenment had prepared the path. Je cours, to name just one, in the Encyclopédie referred to the droit de la nature humaine. With the crisis leading up to the outbreak of the revolution, the terms droit de l'homme gained traction. The Cahiers de Doléances du Tiers État of Mont-de-Marsan, a small place in southwestern France, presumably in April 1789, complained, les droits de l'homme, la raison et la justice n'ont jamais été la base sur laquelle on a fondé les différentes constitutions de son gouvernement. Il est temps qu'on pose des règles fixes et qu'on assure à la France une constitution qui garantisse les droits naturels et imprescriptibles des hommes. Consequently, they demanded a constitution for the country. Les principes de cette constitution doivent être renfermés dans une déclaration des droits naturels de l'homme. The Surrey State of Montpellier agreed that France should be re-established dans tous ses droits de l'homme et des citoyens. Everyday politics of the Ancien Régime, echoed the Surrey State of Nemours, were instead odieuse à tous ceux qui respectent les droits de l'homme et des citoyens. In most cases, the complaints specified those rights which were considered missing or not observed. But long before the first Declaration of Rights was drafted in the French Revolution, recourse to the droit de l'homme et du citoyen was taken whenever the specific case should give way to the general principle that was considered more commanding and compelling. Therefore, those to be elected from the Aix-en-Provence region were to be instructed de proposer à l'Assemblée nationale comme un objet vraiment préliminaire l'examen, la rédaction et la déclaration de tous les droits naturels et imprescriptibles des hommes, de l'homme et des citoyens, déclaration qui suivra de base de toutes les lois, soit politiques, soit civiles, qui pourront émaner, tant à présent qu'à l'avenir, de toutes les assemblées nationales. Whereas the Americans insisted on rights established or newly created to provide practical protection against illegal encroachments undertaken by any authority, the French relied on abstract theory to be proclaimed as eternal truths. Emanating from the rationalism of the French Enlightenment, the proclamation of sweeping abstract principles appeared to be the best help to right wrongs and to lead to a better future, replacing century-old absurdities, inequalities, and irrationality. In this sense, the Déclaration des droits de l'homme et des citoyens of the 26th of August 1789 was proclaimed. As it addressed at the same time human rights and civil rights, it was clearly a document conceived for France and not a universal manifesto. But as human rights were considered to be the expression of universal truth, its meaning was not restricted to France and resounded across the globe. This contradiction inherent in the French declarations of 1789, 1791, 1793, and 1795 could not pass unnoticed. On the one hand, they proclaimed human rights as natural rights, not originating from any particular state and universal in its scope and meaning. On the other hand, they contained civil rights, defined by a specific political order and restricted to its citizens at the exclusion of those living in the community but not belonging to it. While stable, the political order seems to be the dividing line between those two different rights, some general, some local, they tend to obscure the fact that the existence of the constitutionally organized state is a precondition for those types of rights to become relevant, just as Article 12 of the Déclaration des droits de l'homme et des citoyens 1789 had indicated. If natural universal rights presuppose the modern state in order to unfold, instead of coming down to us from an imagined prehistorical state of nature without any fear interference by a state, these rights are nothing else than an invention of the modern state, mystifying the legitimacy of its actions and their limits. Why should any potent ruler, even a normal government, adhere to such ideas? The French Revolution is known for its declarations of human rights, not for any kind of human rights policy. None of the Napoleonic constitutions, inside and outside of France, included declarations of human rights. nor did any subsequent European constitution of the 19th century. The heyday of the revolution was long gone, and with it, the ideas of the French Enlightenment and of natural law had given way to a substantially changed climate of opinion. It was a time when Jeremy Bentham, insisting on the British, quote, aversion to abstract propositions, might more easily find followers tearing natural law to pieces. Quote, natural rights is simple nonsense. Natural and imprescriptible rights, rhetorical nonsense. Nonsense upon stilts. Nonetheless, human rights continued to have their adherents throughout the 19th century in Latin America. But the French example lived on, especially in a number of Colombian constitutions between 1811 and 1819, some of them copying verbatim parts of the preamble of the French Declaration of 1789. As for instance, the Constitution of Pamplona de Indias of 1815, its long final chapter on derechos del hombre y del ciudadano que se reconocerán y respetarán en todo el Estado, in its initial article 100. As in the French original, it denounced forgetfulness and contempt of the rights of man as the sole causes of the misery and corruption, which at all times and in all places made the members of the human species suffer. What followed, however, were sections on soberanía del pueblo, derechos del hombre en sociedad, derechos del ciudadano, deberes del hombre en sociedad, and deberes cuerpo social. Another example is Mexico, where the constitutional design set by the Constitution of Cádiz by 1812 had a long-lasting impact, so that formal declarations of rights were rare in the first half of the 19th century. Nonetheless, at least liberals seemed to have had no doubt in the existence of human rights. As the proyecto, the Reglamento Político del Gobierno del Imperio Mexicano of 1822 contained the rather casual provision, nada más conforme a los derechos del hombre que la libertad de pensar y manifestar sus ideas, article 17. Almost as a matter of course, the Mexican Constitution of 1857 began its provision, el pueblo mexicano reconoce que los derechos del hombre son la base del respeto de las instituciones sociales. Article 1. A long section of 29 articles on human rights followed, but as before in Mexico or in Colombia, without any reference to natural law. These randomly taken examples do not suggest speaking for Latin America as a whole in the 19th century, but they indicate that the French ideas of human rights easily crossed the Atlantic and inspired liberals in the rising new nations of Hispanoamerica. The situation in 19th century Europe was notably different. No constitution reclaimed human rights. To be sure, in Germany in 1848, the term Grundrechte, as I said already, basic or fundamental rights, achieved constitutional currency, consciously introduced against the term human rights, which remained closely associated with the French Revolution, and therefore, with the exception of the democratic left, was rejected due to its radicalism. Though some of the rights declared in the Paul Stegner Constitution could be understood as human rights, the debate in Germany for the rest of the century continued around the question whether man really was born with specific indescriptible rights and whether rights could only be granted. European constitutions of the 19th century preferred indeed, some hesitantly, others more straightforwardly, a number of civil rights which might be granted or if need be restricted or cancelled. Though considered indispensable, the constitution of the Second Republic failed to contain a Déclaration des droits de l'homme et des citoyens. Article 3 of the preamble ambiguously declared that the French Republic reconnaît les droits et les devoirs antérieurs et supérieurs aux lois positives, which could mean those proclaimed by the subsequent constitution. As a telling, it failed to add after the droit de l'homme et des citoyens. Consequently, the constitution only contained droit de citoyen garanti par la constitution. In Europe, this public